Welcome. You're watching NewsX and I am Meenakshi Upreti. Today, of course, the topic of discussion really is the reopening of schools. Students are going finally to schools after a gap of a year and a half, 17 months in the case of the national capital. How are they coping up with it? What are the anxiety of parents who are sending their children to schools like? What their careers look like, students who have missed their studies or perhaps who choose really to stay at home, keeping, of course, the overall situation of the COVID pandemic in mind. To discuss all this and more, I have an expert panel, a parent association leader also. Let me introduce everyone. First of all, thank you everyone for taking out the time and talking to NewsX. I am joined by Dr. Smita Malhotra, Senior Consultant, Pediatric Gastroenterology, Indraprastha Apollo Hospitals. I am joined by Dr. Krishnan Chuk, Principal Director and HOD of Pediatrics, Fortis, Gurgaon. I am joined also by Dr. Amrita Das. She is the founder of ICS Institute for Career Studies. I am joined also by Dr. Shweta Sharma. She's a clinical psychologist and founder of the Mansa Global Foundation for Mental Health. Also, Dr. Shuchin Bajaj, founder director, Ujala Sinus Group of Hospital. Thank you all for joining us on NewsX. We'll be joined by a parent, Sumit Vora, also later. And we'll be taking questions, anxieties, etc. of all the parents. Dr. Chug, my first question to you. Now, as far as the situation is concerned, there is a lot of anxiety amongst parents, amongst students. The first question which we are getting from most parents really is that how can they keep their children safe? Younger children generally don't want to follow COVID protocols. So how do you keep them safe? How do you really teach them on how they can maintain social distance, mask up, ensure 6 feet distancing, etc.? Your suggestion, advice for parents.
Well, we all understand that there is a lot of anxiety, which is natural. Now, for children, we also know that it's going to be very, very difficult to convince them to follow the protocols for, let's say, 3, 4, 5, 6 hours that they may be in the school. It's a long, long time. It's not just I'm being exposed to somebody, like I go to see a patient for 15 minutes and with him, I can put my mask tightly and maybe double mask and everything. But for children, it's going to be tough. So we have to work out some methods which are practical and yet give at least a decent degree of safety. Perfect safety may not be possible. So for example, if you have to tell them to put masks, at least when they are with each other, let's say in the class and not in a playground where they could be at a distance from each other, they have to wear the mask. The mask has to cover the face, the mouth as well as the nose. And if you want them to carry on this for hours and hours without a break, it's not possible. That means after every, let's say, period or a class of, let's say, 30, 40 minutes, let's give them a break of 10 minutes where they can spread out, remove their mask, take some deep breaths if they want to, put that mask back, come back on the seat. The other is that in the class, there should not be as many children as they were originally, which means if a class had 40 desks for one each and 40 students, now we should not allow more than 20 or maybe even less. So yes, the distance is maintained. Somebody is not wearing a mask perfectly, and yet at least a distance will save him to some degree. Then the third is that if we give them a break in the middle for a tiffin or a lunch break or something, at that time it is going to be a next impossible to maintain because they have to eat, they have to drink their water, so they will remove their masks. If we call them only for 2.5 hours, 3 hours maximum, and in between we do not give them a break, and after that this lot goes and the next lot comes, which means we have maintained that we are not going to give them 30 minutes, 25 minutes, 20 minutes for eating their, let's say, sandwich or whatever. So, because to expect that they will go and sit in one corner and the other corner and there'll be a distance of 6 feet or more while they're enjoying their sandwich, it's going to be impossible. So we have to first provide and make sure that we are giving them something which is practical. That's my advice.
Right. And Dr. Shweta Sharma, you know, as a clinical psychologist, I'm sure you've also met a lot of parents who have anxiety about sending their children to schools after such a long gap. Now, of course, Dr. Chugh has some valuable advice and suggestions to give. What are you telling really any of your patients who are coming to you with anxiety issues, considering it is a difficult time for parents? And how are they to really convince their children to take all the steps which Dr. Chugh has spoken about? Of course, as far as schools are concerned, they're working at a 50% capacity. Schools claim they're taking all precautions in mind, but it's quite difficult in a physical classroom environment, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely, because your children are going to, you know, meet their classmates, especially their teachers, physically after 1.5 years, and they are completely stuck, completely frustrated. Anxiety issues are very much high with the children. So parents are coming with the mixed feeling, actually, because they are anxious, but at the same time they are excited also ki finally their children are going to have that real world, apart from that virtual classes, apart from that virtual friendship. Finally they are going to have that actual experience. But yeah, that anxiety is very high, and in such cases we are suggesting to have that friendly communication with the child so that they can understand well. They should not feel restricted ki no, I need to wear mask all the time, I can't enjoy with friends, I can't enjoy with my classmates, or maybe I can't talk to my teacher directly. Because usually, especially when we talk about, you know, that teenage children, they usually wants to carry away with the flow. Okay, let's go and talk, let's do the hug and other things. So that physical touch is very much important for them, and especially after when such a long period is missing for them. So in that case, only friendly advice will come from the parents.
Friendly advice is one suggestion. I got your point, but let me also bring in Dr. Smita Malhotra also. Ma'am, earlier last week we'd spoken about the immunity of children, and then we had focused a lot on younger children, even babies, because they have, of course, a natural immunity, which we did discuss in detail. But today we're talking about class 9 and above. Do you think now classes should reopen for younger children also, maybe class 6 onwards, or do you think it's time to really reframe?
I think we need to reopen, because we are getting lots of children with lots of other health issues because of being closed indoors for almost more than a year and a half almost. So as I mentioned in my last discussion, we have had so many children who have come up with psychological issues, with vague pain abdomen, which doesn't have any organic cause. They have come up with weight gain. So they definitely need to go ahead with their life now. And I think children, we all know, have a milder disease. And once the people around them are well vaccinated, their families are vaccinated, their teachers are vaccinated.
The carriers at the end of the day, isn't it, ma'am?
Yes, they can be. But then when everything else is open, so why only schools? We all know that children have milder disease. And adult population, significantly, we have vaccinated. Most of the adults in the homes are vaccinated. So the people they're going back to are vaccinated. It's the children who are not vaccinated. So we do the ones... They will spread it. If they spread it, it will be among themselves or to the adults in the family who will have immunity. So I think there can be some groups which can be restricted, like children who have immune deficiencies, children who are on chemotherapy, children who have long diseases which require treatments which suppress their immunity, like post-transplant kids, kidney transplants, stem cell transplants. These kids, younger age groups, we can restrict, but children who have no comorbidities, who are healthy, I think above class 6 also they should be opened. Obviously, it depends on the number of cases in the area. If we have rising cases, obviously, this is a dynamic situation. It will change as the numbers change.
As of now, you think schools should reopen? Dr. Sachin Bajaj, since you're the founder of a group of hospitals, sir, help us understand really, as far as children are considered, yes, they have a greater immunity. Would you also agree with Dr. Malhotra? Many say children's studies have suffered, or do you think it should wait for some time reopening of school given the situation?
On the contrary, I think we are already past the date when we should have reopened. We've reopened everything else. And as everyone is on the panel, I think agrees, we already have seen that the children in Delhi have almost a 60% seropositivity rate. So we are very sure that they all have a mild disease. And as you pointed out, the point about them being carriers, I think this is the time to reiterate very strongly that because of this reason, we should emphasize very clearly that everyone around these children, whether it be teachers or support staff or their parents, they must get vaccinations on priority. They should not delay even for a day now. If they have not been vaccinated, they should be very careful of sending their children out. Because you see, even once the schools reopen, the pre and post COVID classroom experience will be very different now. It will not go back to like what it was 2 years earlier. It will be a very different experience. And we have to keep teaching children on the safety protocols, on how to, you know, keep themselves socially distant, sanitize their hands, keep the masks up. It'll be like going back to their nursery days when they were taught to wash their hands after using the toilet. I think all the basics will have to start coming in again.
All right, point taken. Dr. Amrita Das, reopening of schools extremely crucial. Even the health sector agrees. You know, since you're dealing with higher education, even career counseling, help us understand really, does it affect the psyche of students at all, those who have missed their classes for so long, or do you think it affects their career adversely at all?
It definitely has had a very negative impact on students, because whereas academic classes could happen and to some extent co-curricular activities in a virtual mode, that is not enough for the all-round development of students. And it is through all-round development that they build on employability skills through group activities, through opportunities of leadership, creativity, and so on. Also, a lot of students did not have access to online classes because some schools didn't conduct them. And some schools where they were conducted had students with poor connectivity. So there were students who missed out completely, and they're super excited to get back to school and to get back into the entire excitement of teaching and learning and co-curricular activities. There has been a lot of anxiety, a lot of stress about the future, especially after board exams were canceled. They were care about its cancellation, but the concerns were about higher education. So the kind of experience you have in school helps you for that. Now there's another...
Okay, go ahead, ma'am.
So there's another important issue there. Nobody is discussing the impact on nursery and KG children. I also feel that in very small numbers, and many educationalists have stressed it, including Mrs. Meenakshi Sahni, the principal of Modern School Vasant Vihar, that younger kids, for their emotional and social development, need to have experiences which cannot be replicated online. So in small groups, with parent support, parents volunteering, we must get them back because they have suffered the most. They have suffered in terms of emotional development, social, in terms of language, everything. Okay. It's been 2 years lost for them. And parents are not trained sufficiently for the kind of education that nursery and KG kids require. So let's look at opportunities for them.
Okay, point taken. You say even nursery and KG students are suffering, maybe those classes, yes. We should look at reopening them as well. Sumit Vora, since you, of course, represent, students' side, the parents' side, help us understand, because when we spoke in the morning, you were pretty much against the idea because parents genuinely have a lot of anxiety.
Yeah, ma'am. I'll start with today only. There's a school in Mandima called High Court Butler School. Only five students reached the school today from 10th, 11th, 12th school. So first example, I'm giving you this. Second day is that all the doctors are predicting, all the health specialists, with due respect to the doctor or the health fraternity, they're predicting of the third wave. How can you expect parents to send their child who are 5-year-old, 4-year-old or nursery or even the senior ones to go to a school? And everyone says it's imminent, it will come, third will come. then the school themselves are not very sure. A Mount Carmel school, a very popular chain, around 40 years old chain. They've got four or five schools. One in Aniketan, two in Dwarka, one in Gurgaon. Okay. They have postponed the whole process till October. So the school fraternity also is a bit skeptical. And what is the guarantee whether the SOPs would be followed in the schools or not? How can you expect a nursery child to social distance himself or a KG child to make it sure it does not share his tiffin or her tiffin with anyone? So what, as per our survey, 80% of parents are not ready to send the children to the school right now. Third wave, and fourth thing I would like to add, without transportation, everything is saying, some things are very logical. I understand, I myself in this section from last 12 years, but without transportation, how can you expect a parent to drop their kids in the morning who are coming to, let's say, to Vasant Vihar from Punjabi Bagh and come back again?
Okay, so you're making it a little Delhi-centering for a pan-India audience. So basically what Mr. Vora is saying, there are two different areas in the national capital since transportation is not provided by many schools because they don't want to put a lot of kids
none of the schools.
All right, all schools almost. And that's why parents are facing a big inconvenience. But Dr. Singhal, do come in here. I didn't introduce you because you joined us a little 2 minutes later. So Dr. Singhal, of course, is a psychiatrist. She is from the Safdarjung Hospital. Thank you, ma'am, for joining us. So you heard Mr. Vohra. He's actually bringing the point of the parents. All the doctors are given, they've given a bunch of suggestions. Psychologists, psychiatrists like you talk about counseling, but parents have a lot of apprehension. Five students attending one school, 80% of, parents associated with him say they don't want to send their children to school. How do you see this?
So thank you so much for inviting me to the panel. And yes, I was a little bit late. So I'm a little repetitive here. I sort of lost out on the initial part of the discussion. But I did hear Mr. Sumit Vohra speak about and describe some of the anxieties that a lot of parents might be facing right now. And I think it's actually very legitimate. And it's very, very natural for parents and children and teachers and the school people as well to have all these anxieties because these are unprecedented times. These are times of uncertainties. And no one can't really be ever sure as to what's going to happen next. Again, like you mentioned, that all the doctors and the health experts have been predicting a third wave. But again, that's really just a prediction. We can't really be sure. And when we are faced with such uncertain situations, anxiety is a very, very normal emotion for us to go through. So while I do understand and I do want to validate some of the anxious emotions and the stress and the worries that parents might be going through, the situation right now that we have at hand is that this is right here, right now with us, and we need to find the best ways in which we can deal with the situation as a parent, as a child, and from the school administration staff. I think one of the most important things that needs to be at the center of all of this is an open and honest dialogue between all the stakeholders, which means an honest dialogue between the parents and their children. Because whatever parents go through and the way parents choose to deal with this situation and the way they choose to cope with this situation is a very good demonstration as to how their child is going to be dealing with it in school.
Communication at home, that's your suggestion. I'll come back to Mr. Vohra on that. But Dr. Chugh, we're hearing this point again and again that the third wave, the impending third wave is going to come. And parents are anxious, even though they are vaccinated, they're not sending their children to school. Really help us understand how real is this fear of third wave? Because ICMR now claims that the third wave is almost here.
Well, it's a big country. So what I say, we may apply to, let's say, Delhi area and may not apply to Kerala, where the second wave is still not over. So as such, the real third wave has not yet come. If I take the NCR region, it is very clear that consistently for weeks now, cases have been less than 100, positivity rate point less than 0.1%. So, so this is a very good time, a good window that we have at least to start opening. When you open, and if we are able to, let's say, keep our children safe for next, let's say, 4 weeks, 6 weeks through September and maybe before the Diwali season starts, we would have a good taste and good idea what we should be doing. And at that time, close the schools again. Not for the 4, 5, 7 days of school but let's say for almost 3-4 weeks, so that the Diwali gatherings that have occurred, their effect would be seen within 2 weeks or so. So if no increase in cases have occurred, then we reopen the schools and carry on. If there is an impact that we see is getting out of hand, and by then our predictors, prediction people are also saying that if it has to come, the third wave is likely to come in October, November. So we would know that whether it's coming or not. And accordingly, we can take a call whether we are going to open the schools again in November after Diwali or not. But this next 6 weeks, 8 weeks is a good period to try and say, even if we call it experiment and see what happens.
You know, so you call it experiment.
Which parents would like to get their experiment done on their children in this crucial period? Something has been said now.
So I take back that word of experiment.
Point taken, Dr. Vera. But what Dr. Chugh was trying to say, that in a larger context, perhaps it's time to give it a try. But I understand your worry as a parent. And we also have another pediatrician in the panel, Dr. Smita Malhotra. I will include everyone in the panel. Even if the debate gets extended, we'll extend it. That's not a problem. I hope you all have a little more time and to bear with us. It's a very important discussion. Dr. Malhotra, I think Mr. Vora also made an important point. How do you convince parents? Anxiety is very real. And the biggest question, which as I said, many parents are asking us also, all right, ma'am, we are vaccinated. Very good that you all are opening schools. But what if my child brings the virus home? I have the elderly. I have the susceptible at home. And it's difficult to separate children from their grandparents. What do they do in that case?
See, I think I understand Mr. Vora's anxieties, but let us also understand that everything has to be in perspective. We cannot be selective about our anxieties. You all saw the pictures after we opened about Manali and everywhere. Everyone, you go to any restaurant, they're all full. So we are up and out and about when we have to enjoy. But when it comes to school, we have anxieties. So we cannot have selective anxieties. Who did not celebrate Raksha Bandhan? Who stayed indoors? Everybody is meeting their parties, their get-togethers. So everything is going on in full throng. And when we, whatever we do, it is against the backdrop. It's always a risk and benefit ratio that has to be seen. In life, everywhere we take some risks to gain some benefits. As Dr. Chugh said, I fully veto what he has said. That, yeah, the numbers presently are consistently low. So if not now, then when? This is the time when we have to venture out, when we have to, you know, it is not an experiment. It's an opportunity for us to see. And it's always a dynamic situation. If we have cases rising, we can always close back again.
Again, right. And, you know, Dr. Singhal and Dr. Sharma, both of you are psychologists here. Would you like to say something to parents like Mr. Vora who are anxious?
I think what can also we another strategy that we can employ here is a shift in the way that we are perceiving the situation. You know, having a unimodal view where we're only looking at the harms of reopening schools is going to lead us to making probably not so wise decisions, because we need to see the pros and cons of the situation here. Yes, opening up schools right now might be a risky venture, but then there are also a lot of disadvantages of having our children locked up in their houses, having online education systems not enabling their all-round development growth. Teenage is a very, very important critical stage where the mind needs to develop emotional quotient. Children need to learn how to be able to read other faces, how to be ready for the out there real world. And this is what schooling and education is about, preparing them for the real world outside, which is not something that we can provide in the online environment. And in a way, I would again say that this is not an experiment. This is rather a shot at normalcy. This is how we sort of try to venture into collectively.
I think it was very pertinently a shortest normalcy. And I think that's exactly the point. The other conditions. Absolutely. They were also making in the same panel that the numbers are low. This is the time really to try. But Dr. Sharma, would you like to add something here as a psychologist? And I'll come to you, Dr. Bajaj.
Yeah, so as per the concern of Mr. Sumit Vehra, he's very right, and I agree with others' opinion because, you know, we are focusing on other things where spaces are open, public places are open, and we are actually going with the children just for the sake to change the environment. So what is the issue with the schools? And where there is a choice, you don't need to send them regularly, you can send them on alternated basis, and the schools are not compiling you to send your kids regularly. So you can send at least twice or thrice in a week. But that change is much required for their psychological health, because you know that anxiety, depression is already on peak with the children. They are frustrated. They are coming with the issues. Even parents are coming with the issue that interpersonal relationship is already disturbed, and especially with that age group. So per my opinion, if psychologically we are going to consider, and with all the precautions, with all the measures taken care of, I think this step should be appreciable by the government.
I tell you why they have this anxiety, and Dr. Bajaj, you could come in here as the founder of a hospital. Many reports have come in on how the infrastructure of hospital is not very well prepared in case children get affected in the third wave. Another report has come, that's by the MHRA, which says that children could be, affected like adults when this third wave comes in. And that's also why the anxiety of parents.
So Meenakshi, I'll just add a little bit to what you had said in the beginning, that this debate seems like very centered around Delhi and very middle class and upper middle class. We are unfortunately forgetting about the vast majority of India that is not accessing all these things, right? So the digital divide that we are forgetting, all the children that do not have access to phones or digital devices to attend classes. We are forgetting about people who have just one smartphone in the house and their father takes it with them to work. To the parents who are anxious, I just want to reassure you that if the children can bring the virus home, so can you, right? So if you are also not going out, if you are not working, if you are staying at home all the time, then it is, I think, justified to expect your children also to stay. But if you're going out every time, you're going to office, you're going to parties, you're going visiting, and then you expect that your children should stay at home just because there's a risk of them bringing home the virus, I think that's absolutely unjustified right now. But even if you are anxious, let us reassure you that all schools are making it optional for you. You can still attend online. It is not compulsory for you to send your children, but please do allow the other children to go who are, you know, in need of the physical environment, who are developing psychological issues, who are developing obesity sitting at home, who are developing loss of confidence. We are seeing so many children coming to our hospitals who cannot even speak now, even though they're seventh or eighth class, they have not spoken to any person in the real physical environment. They don't know how to open up. They don't know how to make friends. So I think it's something that the anxiety is appreciable. I truly appreciate it.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.